Welcome to Space News from the Electric Universe, brought to you by the Thunderbolts Project at thunderbolts.info. On August 12, 2018, NASA's Parker Solar Probe was launched from Cape Canaveral, Florida, beginning its historic journey that would take it closer to the Sun than any man-made object to date. In early December, the first scientific papers were published on the mission's earliest findings. The first four papers have suggested a number of, quote, surprising discoveries, including the speed of the solar wind rotating around the sun, and the behaviors of dust particles that the probe has encountered at its perihelion. From the perspective of the electric sun model, perhaps the most intriguing discovery to date is the, quote, unexpected changes in the sun's magnetic field, which the probe encountered as it moved through the plasma environment. As one news report describes, unexpectedly, the probe also detected a series of flips in the sun's magnetic fields, dubbed switchbacks, as streaming winds of plasma flowed past the spacecraft. During these periods, the magnetic field suddenly reversed itself by 180 degrees and then, seconds to hours later, flipped back. In part one of this two-part presentation, retired professor of electrical engineering Dr. Donald Scott begins his analysis of the Parker probe data.
Well, about a week or so ago, at a NASA press conference, the investigators that are in charge of the Parker solar probe described their new findings from the first flybys of that probe. Now, as far as I have been able to find out, the probe has made about three closer and closer passages to the sun, and it will continue to do that for several years, and hopefully, if it doesn't burn up, it'll continue to do that. But in any event, the NASA press conference included the statement, which is sort of typical of them, quote, "This is the first time we've been able to fly a spacecraft into the atmosphere of a star." Well, they said that last time too, and I commented that on that kind of statement. It all depends on what you call the atmosphere of a star. What is the sun's atmosphere? Well, the sun's local plasma extends out to the extent of the heliosphere, which ends in what we call the heliopause, and that's several times the distance out of Pluto. So by definition, any probe or satellite that gets out of Earth's atmosphere is in the sun's atmosphere, if you realize the sun's atmosphere goes out that far. But actually, the proper question is, how close to the sun's photospheric surface will the Parker probe get? Will it get into the sun's corona? Will it get below the corona? Oh, no, certainly not. It will not get below the corona. Nothing's going to, in the foreseeable future, will ever get through that kind of temperature. But NASA says that the probe will, in 2025, get within a distance of 4 million miles. Okay, I think, as I said last time, that 4 million miles is about 9 solar radii. That is, if you take a picture of the sun during a full solar eclipse and see the corona there, if you look and scale the distance, let's say, from the center of the sun to the edge of the black dot, the shadow of the moon in front of the sun, that's, of course, the solar radius. And so if you measure out 10 times that distance, that's where closest approach of the Parker probe will get. It used to be said that the farthest out that the corona extends is about 5 solar radii. So I said last time, and I still think it, that the Parker probe was not going to get even close to the outermost regions of the corona. But recently, NASA says, no, the corona extends out to something like 5 million miles, 12 solar radii, and so it may get in, depending on when, I guess, the feelings of the sun at the moment, how far it extends its corona, it may touch the outer reaches of the corona. But they're assuming it's going to. The press release goes on to say that the present data that they're getting back, quote, hints at the likely birthplace of dynamic solar winds, which bathe our entire solar system in energy. And that's certainly true. They continue, they say, it describes startling reversals, that is to say, switchbacks in the sun's magnetic fields. And it detects dust in the solar wind, and it shows that solar winds spin. And they say, of course, in their airy, frivolous language, it spins like children riding on a playground carousel. Anyway, if you can get through that, whenever you hear about things spinning, just quietly think about the fact that force-free currents are collections of counter-rotating, spinning magnetic field and current pathways. I submit, and I have submitted for a long while, that they're about the only natural phenomenon that do consist of concentric counter-rotating cylinders that do indeed spin, or at least twist. In one of our last space news segments, we discussed reports that the Voyager probes have observed unexpected rotation of the magnetic field through which it is traveling. That is, the Voyagers. They're out at the other end of the thing, they're out at the heliopause. And my comment at that time says that, wow, that's fantastic, because that would fit like a hand into a glove with our Juergens electric sun model. And that would say that, yes, they have left the heliopause, the heliosphere, out through the heliopause, but it still hasn't left the giant Birkeland current that feeds this whole solar system and feeds our sun. Still seeing the rotating magnetic fields within that Birkeland current. Back to the present, though, the present report, I feel it's very likely that the pointed tops of the so-called coronal caps, regions where the rays of plasma that are leaving up through the corona, instead of diverging from a central point, i.e. the sun, after they leave, they seem to, at certain places at least, come back together again and form a triangular or at least a conical kind of a cap. But anyway, a longtime EU member, good friend of ours, Chris Reeve, apparently asked the question, isn't it possible that these switchbacks are simply the probe moving through the counterflowing Birkeland current cylinders of each filament? And when I saw that, I said, hurrah, thank you, Chris. Yes, it absolutely is, of course, yes. It's quite likely that the coronal caps, those pointed hat shapes we observe in the outer regions of the corona, are exactly where Birkeland currents form. And those Birkeland currents extend out to places like the north poles of the planets. So Birkeland currents would explain the spinning and the reversal of direction of magnetic fields that the Parker Solar Probe observes and that the investigators have found so typically surprising.
Scientific reports describe the Parker probe being bombarded with dust particles during its closest approaches to the sun. A phys.org report states, another surprise was the dust that peppered the spacecraft repeatedly during each flyby at perihelion. The dust particles are likely debris from asteroids or comets, then melted near the sun and left behind their trapped dust. But this begs the question, how large an amount of rocky comet and asteroid material would have to be spread through such an unimaginably vast volume of space? We asked Dr. Scott how the electric sun model of the solar plasma environment might better explain the presence of such dust.
I think that explanation is it's akin to the typical explanation that they give for why are there all sorts of different elements, you know, manganese, calcium, iron, sulfur, oxygen, you name it, all the other elements in addition to the hydrogen and helium that their model says has to be there. But their model of nuclear fusion does not produce manganese, calcium, oxygen, sulfur, and all the raft of other elements. And so where does it come from? In deeper outer cosmic space, there are novae explosions, suns explode, and they pepper the universe with, and Scott adds parenthetically, fairy dust that sprinkles throughout the galaxies and intergalactic space. And that's how all these other kinds of elements that the sun doesn't generate, that's how they get on the sun. It's like a snowstorm, and they come in from out deeper outer space. Now, if you believe that, I got a bridge that connects Manhattan and Brooklyn. I would be very willing to sell you. Alfvén and all the earlier plasma physicists were well aware that most plasmas are what are called dusty plasmas. And that means that they contain neutrals. A fully ionized plasma is very rare. They say that the outer regions of the coronas are corona of our sun and probably other stars are fully ionized plasma, but 99% of most plasmas are not fully ionized. In fact, Hannes Alfvén was quoted as saying, if the plasma was more than 10% ionized, it could be considered a fully ionized plasma because the forces between the ions and electrons that were there are so much stronger than the gravitation between the neutrals that the neutrals, the gravitational effects just don't count. So that's a long-winded way of saying, sure, plasmas are dusty. That's where the dust comes from. It comes from within the sun as the ions and the electrons come blasting out of the sun. They bring neutrals with them, and that's where it came from. I don't think you have to depend on asteroids melting in the near the sun to explain that.